Hello, greetings everyone. First of all, let me say that it's a pleasure to be here, and especially because it's an opportunity for me to reflect about my own work as a geneticist, working with the endangered species in the context of Africa, particularly in Guinea-Bissau. So today I would like to propose a reflection about what exactly means for us to enter in a genomic era. So I propose today to speak about the Human Genome Project. Actually, we are celebrating this year 20 years after the first draft of the Human Genome Project was released. In fact, the complete and the total sequence was revealed just a few months ago, because there were some bits that were lacking. And these, after 20 years have been passed since this project began, and many possibilities emerged, but also some ethical dilemmas too. So the Human Genome Project began around the 90s, when there was a necessity to understand the sequence of the nucleotides that compose the genome. Genome is the total amount of genes that an organism possess. And in spite of this name, the Human Genome Project, the project itself encompassed several organisms too, that allow a direct comparison between the in terms of biology and genetics, because it was possible to understand what we have in common and what we have different with other species. And of course, other possibilities like the genome of the Neanderthal, the genome of some species that causes harm to humans, like the parasite of the malaria, or some of the mosquitoes that are vectors for some diseases. So this possibility of the human genome offered a direct impact on the society, and not only on the medicine field, but also in the advance of the new technologies, particularly in the bioinformatics field. However, several issues start to appear from the beginning. So the Human Genome Project began around the 90s, although there was some movements towards the sequencing of the total genome. But it was on the 90s that two streams of research emerged. A public consortium involved six countries, that a big amount of investment was made to sequence these the Human Genome Project and other organisms too, and a private sector from Celera Genomics, promoted by Craig Venter, that was also interested to sequence the human genome with the different approaches and with different missions too. Of course, for the Celera, the idea was to make a kind of a contribution, but of course, as a private, they wanted to apply this research in some kind of technology and compared to the public consortium, it was not like that. So from the beginning, some ethical aspects start to appear, like, for example, the patent of genes. So it's possible that the human gene can be patented by a company, or as soon as we have a sequence, a total sequence, this sequence should be available to everyone to research, available to all the community that want to do some research. So there was a big debate around this issue concerning the gene patents that reached with a declaration from the United Nations stating that the gene patents are free and available because they, in fact, they are shared patrimony to all, and all of us can use it. But there was a big movement, particularly from secure insurance companies, that were asking genetic tests to people to be sure that they don't develop genetic diseases later. And there was a big debate on the 90s and on the beginning of the 2000s around this problematic that emerged from the Human Genome Project. Other issue that actually we are also, there is a milestone this year that 25 years have been passed since the cloning of the Dolly sheep. And this was a big issue also on the society, because this particular sheep was developed by a mature somatic cell and three sheep were involved, female sheep were involved in the process of the cloning, one that gave the ovula, the other that was that were the actually mother, and the other one that gave the cell. So this cloning of this sheep open a big debate, questioning if scientists were playing like God, because they are already creating new kind of animals, and people were scared at the moment that what scientists can do, because now they can clone these animals, and the reproductive cloning was a big issue at that time as well. Other problematic, other dilemma that appear with the Human Genome Project was raised by Luigi Luca Cavalli Sforza, that was an Italian geneticist working in U.S. A very prominent researcher, and he was proposing that okay, we need to understand our own diversity and our own genetic structure. So it is important that diversity could be registered and analyzed to genetic sequences. So the Human Genome Diversity Project started around that time, around 2000, and several samples were collected, particularly from minority groups, ethnic groups, to try to assess the genetic their genetic diversity mainly. But the project itself, this project from Luigi Luca Cavalli Sforza, was very, very controversial, because he was accused of racism. He was accused of trying to impose, by analyzing the genetic difference, to keep this idea of of human race. Actually, it was not the case. In my opinion, it was unfairly accused of that. The questioning around this, the obtaining of the samples is fair because the minority groups and some ethnical groups were confronting the scientists with a simple statement like this. So we are already been in our history part of colonization. You already took from us our ancestors, collecting samples from our without our consent, and now you want to preserve our genetic identity on cubes and analyze it. So it was a big deal, and the project itself it start to decline because there wasn't an ethical reflection in beforehand. Several books were written about this. I advise one book called The Life on Ice. That's very interesting because it analyzed how bloodline cell were from Ella were took from a person without her consent, and how a company then make money with this cell line involving obtaining these biological samples without consent. So definitely we enter in a period that we can call genomics era or a post-genomic era, where using almost instant technology, it's possible to sequence an entire genome and compare the genes or the genetic regions of the genome that are under study in order to understand a particular research question. One direct applications to that of this genomics era is that is also possible to be applied to conservation matters, particularly to endangered species. So in one hand, we have many possibilities that the genomics open for us as humans. On the other hand, we also have several legal and the ethical issues that we need to think. So as the Human Genome Project evolved, there was also evolved the concern of these ethical issues, and it was created the Ethical, Legal and Social Implications Program of the human project, because the scientists realized that these ethical questions are important to be discussed and important to be considered. As the examples I gave, the gene patents, the gene therapy, that it's a promise that the genomics offer. The problematic concerning the human diversity in all the ethnic groups across the countries, it was other problem. The obtaining of the samples without consent, it was also a problem. But on the other hand, it offers us possibilities to understand us as humans, like the Neanderthal genome or other hominid ancestors using the technology of ancient DNA. So for me, I was doing research as biological anthropologist in Guinea-Bissau, working with chimpanzees. And now I would like to reflect about my own research. And I was trying to understand the phylogeography and the historic genetics of those chimpanzees in Guinea-Bissau, because at that time there was a paucity of information regarding them. And I was trying also to assess their genetic structure, how many communities, their diversity, of course, because their genetic diversity is the first level of biodiversity. So it was important for me to understand how these chimpanzees were constituted genetically. So I was the way I was doing that, I was using what is called a non-invasive methodology. So basically, I was searching for chimpanzees around the forests with local guides, and then I collected some non-invasive biological material like feces, hair, blood. If I see that they fight, and by occasion I can collect blood, but more usually it was feces mainly, because the feces, when they pass from the gastrointestinal tract, they carry epithelial cells and from the outer part, and it is possible to extract DNA from